Okay, I'd like to wrap up our time together by giving you one final kind of image for you to walk away with to summarize it all, and then give you a couple practical things that you could do with this. First of all, the question is, how are we to daily follow Christ? And really, it begins at a point in time where we receive the gift to go from death to life. Christ's death we receive to bring us life, to bring us into the family, to bring us into a place where we receive constant love forever. But it also is a daily process of disowning the old belief systems as we begin to progressively work with the Lord on growing more and more to be like Christ. The scripture that comes to mind is something that you're probably familiar with. It is the story of the prodigal son. In Luke chapter 15, Jesus describes it quite a bit. And years ago, I read a book by Henri Nouwen that he really pulled apart this painting by Rembrandt. You could see here, there is a younger son that is being embraced by the father. And there's an elder son that looks a lot like the father, but he's aside. He's standing aloof, looking down, his nose down at the scorn that the younger son, that the younger brother had foolishly squandered away his father's inheritance. And now all that was left is really all that's going to be the elder brother's inheritance. He's the one that's detached. Well, as you really read the story, you realize it's a story of two prodigals, a younger son and an elder son. What the younger son does is blow it, and he blows it big. He basically says, "Father, I don't care about you anymore. I wish you were dead. I want my share of the inheritance, the third, according to the culture of the time, that you will give me in the future. I want it now." So he does it, he takes it. The father miraculously divides his property, which, he would have had a fire sale, probably wouldn't have got everything that was worth, in order to cash in and give this younger son his share of the inheritance. The father does it. He divides himself. He splits his life and all of the things that he's accumulated. And the son takes it into faraway country and really lives in a completely immoral life and basically blows it all. One day, he has nothing left. He's actually, eating with pigs, unclean animals, and he comes to his senses and he says, "I've got a plan. I've got to go back home." And this is precisely what he says. And this is the first part in Luke 15. He says, this is his plan. "I will rise and go to my father, and I will say to him, one, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you." That's the first thing he's going to say. So he's recognizing there's an eternal thing he's done. He's ripped away not only his father, but also at the way God designs things. He has not honored his father. Two, "I am no longer worthy to be called your son." So he's completely humbled. He realizes the shame that is on him. But here's the third part. "Treat me as one of your hired servants." What's he basically saying? Take me back in. You don't have to treat me as family. And I will work my way back to earn my way back into a place of belonging in the community again. Not as one of your sons, but I will pull myself up by my bootstraps. In essence, a little bit like his older brother. He's basically saying, I'm going to get myself back where I need to be through my performance. He's basically trying to make a false conversion from younger brother to older brother, from blowing it, being very immoral, to being upright and doing things the right way, being the good kid. Well, it's interesting. He goes back home, and his father is actually looking in the horizon, sees him, and unlike anything that we would ever know at the time, though it's because fathers didn't do this, if father sees him, he runs, he bares his legs, he runs out and embraces the son. Guess what the son says to him? He says, "Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. And then second, I am no longer worthy to be called your son." But that's it. The father will hear nothing more about it. He doesn't even get a chance to really speak the third part. He doesn't get a chance at all. Immediately, when he says, I'm no longer worthy to be called your son, the father said, but the father said to his servants, bring quickly the best robe and put it on him. And bring a ring, put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring the fattened calf and kill it, and let us celebrate. For this, my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to celebrate. In other words, his father wouldn't even hear about how he didn't belong in the family. He totally interrupted him. His whole scheme about becoming the good kid and earning his way back into the good graces of the community, that wasn't even on his radar. He wouldn't even listen to it. The father immediately recognizes he was dead. Now he's alive. He has passed from death to life. What is the son's job? The son's job is to believe it. The son's job is to accept the celebration, is to receive the grace. He did nothing to deserve it. In fact, quite the opposite. He deserved the opposite. But what he gets is grace. This total sinner was what was brought into the family, not by anything he did, but only by what the father did. The first thing we need to do is believe in the gospel. Believe in him. And we move from death to life. But that's not all. We also are supposed to become, as you read in scripture, in the context, spiritual fathers to other. You see, we are to become like the Father. The main idea, perhaps the key verse of Luke in general, is the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. The Son of Man was like a father to us. We call him sometimes an elder brother. Sometimes we just call him the Son of God, which is obviously the most accurate. But Paul describes himself as a father to his people he wrote to. St. Paul said, I'm a father. In other words, we grow to be like spiritual parents of others. What does that entail? Maturity means we move from just believing in the gospel to becoming the gospel. From just merely accepting the gift to participating in the gift. And Paul describes it this way. He says it this way. For it has been granted to you for the sake of Christ that you should, one, believe in him, but also suffer for his sake. So we first believe in the gospel. We believe in Christ. But we also suffer for Christ's sake. Now, what kind of suffering we're talking about? We're not talking about the kind of suffering that we get back at us when we've sinned against somebody. Well, Christ didn't sin, so that's not it. And we don't, it's not talking about the type of suffering when you do something unknowingly that's not necessarily sin, like take a job that you're not good at and you get suffering back. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about the kind of suffering, first of all, that comes from a broken world, that comes from a world that is fallen, that is not cooperating with its inherent design, its created design. We suffer in this world. That Christ did that as well. But it's also the type of suffering that is called love. You know, love is basically saying, me for you. I'll die so that you could live. And that's what the Father does. He splits himself. He splits his property. He sacrifices his dignity. In fact, when his son comes back, he even sacrifices a calf to feed the whole community, to throw a party. He continues to sacrifice and love. And that's what Christ is saying. When we are going against the current of this fallen world and of the worldly system, we suffer with Christ. We move from death to resurrection. And as we've talked about in our time today, what that means is to step out with first believing and then second with love. Now, that requires a lot of faith to say, I believe that Jesus is all I need to have my needs met, and I can step into suffering. It takes a lot of faith, but that is what we're called to. And don't you see, that is very much part of this story, of this parable that God wants us to really own. So I've got a couple practical ways for you to really take this in and start tracking what does my suffering look like, and how am I supposed specifically to love? First of all, there's something we have here called Fuel. It's a free download on Gospel Enneagram. You got it right here. This activity helps you slow down, reflect on your emotions, your activities, what you're doing, what you're thinking, in order to better understanding what's driving you. There are just four open-ended questions that talk about what you're feeling or thinking or doing, as well as what you're believing. And we need to have that uprooted. That's what U stands for. E stands for exalt, in the sense of what we're going to really lean into the gospel and exalt God for. What's the belief that we're going to uproot, that core belief? And finally, love. How am I going to love this person into this situation? Instead of just reacting to stimulus all the time by certain emotional reactions, or by thinking, or by feeling, or whatever it may be, we're going to instead take a moment and start thinking about the way we operate. So this is a sheet of paper that I encourage you to print out several a day and just start filling in as things come up. As you start hearing that rumble strip that you're getting off the path, the attributes that you realize, you know, things aren't going so good. Let's take a moment and reflect. What am I really believing in this moment? And what am I called to believe? How can I exalt Christ? Now let me re-enter it with a specific kind of love, so I can understand what is going on in me, so I can repent on the spot, as well as to enter into loving people best. Now, it's called Fuel because the idea is you need fuel to power yourself down the road. We've talked about the Enneagram might be a pathway, a GPS, turn-by-turn directions to your future location of Christ-likeness. And it's the engine of the gospel that really gets you there. We want to take a little time of self-reflection that is the fuel for the engine. It allows for you to be aware of what is going on and how you need the gospel and to communicate. And then what I want you to do is to take this slide where you're doing your shadow and your gold, and I want you to fill out for yourself. Use your own words. So everybody's unique. The Enneagram is a system. It's a classification system. All right. Think about it, how we classify animals. It doesn't mean that we think all leopards look the same way. No, they have different spots, but we classify them in the same place. In the same way, the Enneagram is a system. It's a classification system, but you're unique. And not all those words I put up here on earlier slides really were perfectly you. So let's go further with this, because the purpose of this is understanding when you're off, what you're really believing, uprooting it, and then entering back in under the power of the Holy Spirit to love well. So I'm going to have you fill it out for yourself. Second of all, if you haven't taken our assessment, which you probably have, but take it. In there, you'll find more information, like the spiritual disciplines. Here's all the different spiritual disciplines that are listed. They're explained in your full report. If you really create a regular rhythm to remind yourself of the gospel, man, it's a great decision. And it becomes just as common a lot of times as brushing your teeth in the morning, or as able to be able to enter at nighttime and how your nighttime routine. This becomes a regular routine that you allow the gospel to form you, to remind yourself to commune with the Lord. So not just go from stimulus to response, but to take these stimuluses at times, these stressors or whatever it may be, and to really allow God to be in the midst of it and to transform you. So I wanted to end with that story, and I wanted to give you these two different activities, Fuel and spiritual disciplines, that you'll find on your assessment.